Well, so we have to go back to the year 1987, at which time I was joining an expedition of scientific ocean drilling, which was drilling close to the coast of Antarctica at the eastern side of the Weddell Sea. Our main objective for that cruise was not at all to look at warm periods of the past, but it was looking at the history of the Antarctic continent and at what time the ice caps started to form on that continent. Since we already knew that 60, 70 million years ago, there was no ice on Antarctica. And so we can say that the discovery of the Paleocene-Eocene thermal maximum was a direct consequence of serendipity, since we hadn't planned on looking for that at all. I joined that expedition as an expert in microscopic fossils, and those fossils are the remains of unicellular organisms that live on the bottom of the deep sea. The sea where we were drilling at the time of the formation of the sediment was about 1.5 kilometers deep or so. So we're talking deep sea. And the deep ocean is the largest habitat on Earth. If you think of places where organisms live, two-thirds of the world is ocean. And the largest part of the ocean is the deep ocean, not the edges along the continent. So you can argue that if you see things that are changing with organisms that live in this enormous habitat, then we are looking at effects of some kind of change that is global, a global environmental change, a global climate change, something that affects organisms over this huge area on Earth. So while you are drilling, scientific drilling or drilling for oil, you keep going through sediment layers that represent older and older times in Earth's history. And so the topmost sediment was formed, let's say, yesterday. And if you go deeper and deeper in the sediment pile, you get materials that are, in the end, millions and millions of years older. And you recover sediment in intervals of 9.6 meters. One core of sediment is 9.6 meters. And so as soon as you recover a new sediment, the material goes to the scientists who are looking at microscopic fossils. And that means you're getting one step older. And so, to my big surprise, what I found was, as we are getting through the Eocene into the Paleocene, that in between two of the samples, I certainly saw very large changes in the associations of those organisms. And that was not at all what I expected. Before I went on that cruise, I had predicted that we would see relatively minor changes in the populations of those organisms, just because they live in such a very large habitat, which is difficult to change on short timescales. And if we have long and gradual change, then the organisms can adapt them to themselves to change in the environment by slow and gradual changes. So this was a big surprise. And then the question is, what to do with that big surprise? Of course, what you can do while on a drilling ship in the ocean is limited. And so other people on the ship, Jim Kennett and Lowell Stott, started to look at those fossils of those microscopic organisms that I had studied, and they looked at chemical characters of their shells. By looking at the chemical character of the shell, you can get information on the conditions under which that shell was formed. And one of those conditions is the temperature of the water. And so this is, in the meantime, months after this cruise was ended, what they found out was that there was this period of global warming that co-occurred with those changes in the faunas of my small organisms. And those small organisms, again, are important because they live in such a large habitat. And at the time, that was, of course, very interesting. It was published in the journal Nature, but it was very hard to find an explanation for that. And we still have big debates over bits and pieces of the explanation. Jim Zachos, who is the other person who is getting the award and with whom I'm sharing the award, did a lot of work in the coming years on material from different locations in the ocean, where we had also drilled this time interval. And we started to realize that actually we're not just looking at a change in temperature, we are looking at a change in carbon isotopes in those same shells. They are made of calcium carbonate, so we can look at carbon and oxygen. And those changes in carbon isotopes then are actually the same kind of changes that we see at the moment as the result of the emission of large amounts of greenhouse gases. At the same time, and in different locations in the ocean, we also saw evidence for dissolution of calcium carbonate, and so you can say that is the effect of ocean acidification. And so what we then said was, look here, at this time in the past, we see evidence for three phenomena that we in part already see and in part are expecting to become more severe with the present and future climate change, global warming. And that is, we see a change in temperature in the deep oceans, so that means there must have been a global change in temperature. At the same time as that, we see this emission of greenhouse gases in the atmosphere, and at the same time that we see ocean acidification. And so that means that in a time period, which was about 56 million years ago, we actually have evidence for an event of global warming that is similar to and is an analog of the present and future global climate change. We are talking about an episode of global warming taking place on a background climate that was already warmer than today. So this is not a perfect analog. However, what we can learn is actually what went on Earth in a period of rapid global warming in the past. We can try a model for the future, but that is modeling, it's not observation. And so there are many things changing with the emission of greenhouse gases. Global warming is just one of the effects. As we now already starting to see in our present day world, there are many different effects. We're not just talking about a warming planet. We're looking at changes in sea level, rising sea levels. We're looking at ocean acidification. We're looking at the effects of this warming and sea level rise and ocean acidification on organisms living on land and in the oceans. And so we're seeing organisms migrating from lower latitudes to higher latitudes as the world warms. We're seeing plants migrating. Plants, of course, cannot move, but we can have seeds coming out in different latitudes as their parental trees are living. And we see, for instance, in the United States, that vegetation typical for the Gulf Coast was moving northward into Wyoming and Montana. And so what we can see actually is an example of the effects of climate change as more or less things we hadn't thought about beforehand. Things that we couldn't ask our computers to model because we didn't know the right questions to ask. As an example, for instance, we are now seeing with global warming the effects of a changing hydrological cycle. We have more evaporation and we get more and more severe precipitation, rainfall in some areas, whereas other areas get drier. And examples of that phenomenon we see in the geological record of this Paleocene-Eocene thermal maximum. Some of the examples, some of the most beautiful examples of changes in rainfall are from the Pyrenees, sections in the Pyrenees in Spain, where we see the effects of very strongly increased rates of precipitation with the result of erosion of the mountainsides and of big landslides happening at the same time. And we see events like that happening at the moment. And so we have all those different examples that are not just warming, but the effects of warming that we cannot necessarily all predict since they are things that we don't think of. And if we look at the record of the past, then we can see all those events actually happening. And then we can ask the right kind of questions to our computer models. And so what we're having is something of an example of global warming as it actually happened, with the results on different timescales. If you think of migration of animals and plants to higher latitudes, those events happen on timescales of decades to centuries and even millennia. And so we can actually look at the effects on global warming in the past on different timescales. And that will help us predict what is going on with the very different animals and plants living today, but under comparable conditions. So one of the interesting things is that 55 million years ago, there was an extinction of some organisms, but it was not a severe mass extinction as the ones that have happened earlier in Earth's history, such as at the end of the Cretaceous 65 million years ago, and at the end of the Permian 250 million years ago. But the data that we got from the Paleocene-Eocene thermal maximum helped us actually understand that those earlier periods of mass extinction also were linked to global warming. Before that, if you go back to ideas in the 70s and early 80s, many people thought that mass extinctions were the result of things getting colder. Somehow, as humans, we think that things getting cold is kind of bad and then you go extinct. But we now have started to realize that actually periods of global warming at different times in Earth's history have been much more severe for the different kinds of life forms than the periods of cooling have been. And we can see what it is. If you look at the ocean, we can see that the oceans are getting warmer. Oceans are getting warmer, that means that all the cold-blooded organisms that live in those oceans also get warmer. And if you are warmer, then all your internal reactions, like digesting your food, are happening faster. So if you're a cold-blooded animal and the ocean around you is getting warmer, you need more food. But of course, that more food is not necessarily available. And that means that in essence, you have starvation going on in the oceans. Another potential effect, and this is something that we still don't quite understand, we haven't quite reconstructed it well, and our models give us very different answers, is what the effect is on the levels of oxygen in the oceans. We and other organisms that we like all need oxygen to live and to function and to move. And for instance, the fish that we eat, or the shellfish that we eat, or the octopus that we eat, all those organisms need oxygen to live. Oxygen is much less soluble in water at higher temperatures than in lower temperatures. So we already have less oxygen to begin with in the oceans when the oceans are warmer. However, there are many competing effects on oxygen levels, such as the level of activity of organisms as well, that we need to look at if we want to predict whether the oxygen levels at specific places in the ocean are getting higher or lower. By now, for the Paleocene-Eocene thermal maximum, we have information on many localities, for instance, around what presently is the Mediterranean, that oxygen levels became so low that many organisms couldn't live. And so that, of course, leads to loss of biodiversity in those regions where we lose oxygen levels. In addition to that, and this is very complex, and one of the interesting things that people are studying at the moment also, and for which we can provide information from the geological past, is that if organisms start to migrate, their interactions with other organisms change. And you can easily see that, since if you are a plant, then you can move only slowly over generations, whereas animals can walk. And so as we see different organisms start to move to higher latitudes at different speeds, the interactions between those organisms change. And that means that whole ecological system changes. For us as humans, this is very important because in many regions of the world, populations rely on protein from fishing in the oceans. And so if the available proteins from fishing in the oceans is going to decline rapidly, then that is going to have severe effects for human beings. And we already know that at the moment, with our present levels of global warming, such organisms as corals and coral reefs are being severely affected by a combination of global warming and such things as ocean acidification. And if we look at ecosystems in the oceans at low latitudes, then we see that coral reefs are actually the builders of their own environment. And so if we affect coral reefs negatively, then the whole ecosystem, including the organisms that many people rely on to eat, are going to be adversely affected as well. And so those complex reactions by ecosystems are extremely difficult to predict. And from using the fossil record, we can get an example of the kind of interactions between organisms and ecosystems and the effect on global biodiversity that we get as the result of greenhouse gas emissions, which result in global warming and other environmental effects, including changes in the water cycle and changes in the acidity levels of the oceans. Well, actually, the same kind of data that we used to study the past helps us clearly establish that present global warming is the result of fossil fuel burning, because that same signal that we see in carbon isotopes in shells at the Paleocene-Eocene thermal maximum, we see in shells that are forming in the oceans today. So there are clear evidences that the global warming that we see as a result of increasing carbon dioxide levels in the atmosphere are the result of fossil fuel burning. So it is definitely true, and if you look at the Paleocene-Eocene, we have an example of that, that in the past, climate has changed. The world has been much warmer than today, and there has not been an ice sheet on Antarctica. And life on Earth has adapted to that. However, for many people, the question will not be how it goes with the planet. The planet will exist even if we humans are extinct. But what is important for most people is what will happen to us humans. Our human civilization has developed completely within the last 10,000 years, when climate has been unusually stable. If climate is going to change, if we are inducing major climate change, then the things that will change will affect us. For instance, we've seen that in the past, organisms migrate. So if we look at Connecticut, we have coastal salt marshes. As the sea level rises, in the past, at such events of sea level rise, the salt marshes migrated inland. Now there is I-95 and there is Amtrak. And so the organisms can no longer migrate because us humans are in the way. For us humans, we can expect many changes. If we think of the sea level that we expect to rise in the near future, and in the past even few decades, I am pretty much convinced that we have underestimated the rate of sea level rise, then we will see serious effects on just real estate. I myself am from the Netherlands, and our country has always been very vulnerable to and very aware of the effects of rising sea level. And we expect very large parts of the Netherlands to be underwater. If you look at the United States, just look at New York City. Large part of real estate in New York City will be underwater. A large part of the state of Florida will be underwater. If you just look at the big cities that are within 1 to 2 feet of sea level at the moment, you can see that rising sea levels will cause major changes in where people can live. People will have to migrate, and it will cause a lot of the system, a lot of stress on the system of human culture. If you look at changes in precipitation, you see that where we have dry periods, we will not longer be able to grow crops. And so parts of the areas where at the moment we grow big crops will no longer be suitable to use for agriculture. And so parts of the United States, we will not longer be able to grow the crops we do at the moment. And those crops can be grown much higher latitudes in Canada, for instance. And so if you look at it, the problems of global change are not for the planet and they are not for nature. The problems are for us, because it is our structures that are in the way of global change. And we cannot stop those changes. We cannot stop the change in warming. We cannot stop the rise in sea level unless we do something about CO2 emissions. And so it is very clear that, yes, it is true, we have in the past seen major changes in climate. But some of those episodes of global warming were linked to extremely severe extinctions. And if you look at the extinction, then periods of mass extinction were characterized by the extinction of large organisms. And large organisms are then things that weigh more than, say, 15 pounds. And so it is us humans, and particularly the structures of our civilization, that are going to be a major problem with the climate change that we predict to happen in the near future. Well, as many scientists, I'm very pessimistic. That is never a good point to make. But, you know, we have been talking about this climate change for decades. And I remember that I was at a meeting a bit more than 10 years ago or so, that a number of scientists were all talking about climate change and what we were expecting. And after we all had given our talks, we were kind of sitting together and talking to each other, and we said, you know, one of the scary things of us sitting here and talking is that it sounds like all of us are actually thinking that this is worse than we actually are admitting. All of us seem to say, well, you know, let's not exaggerate, let's not, you know, be too alarmistic. But the point is that all of us seem to be actually slightly more optimistic than we really seriously think if you look at our data. And I still think that is true, as I was just saying. From what we see going on at the moment, global warming is here. We're sitting here in Connecticut, and this time of year, early January, is the time that we had snow that it was freezing every night. It is not freezing every night, and I've hardly had any snow this year. A few days ago, it was 60 degrees. That is extremely unusual. We are already seeing global warming. If you look at those strange alternations between very cold and very warm, that is typical what you expect with global warming. We had this time not that long ago that it was actually warmer in Alaska than it was in Texas. That is absolutely abnormal. And that is totally predicted from the effects of global warming at the higher latitudes in the Arctic, that we get those huge swings between cold and warm climate. In addition to that, those huge changes that we have in precipitation, where it's going to be dry and where it's going to be wet, we see that happening today. And so we cannot say, you know, we can still change everything linked to global warming. It's already here, we cannot change it. And so the question is, and for me this is a question, the question is, how much of the further effects can we still change? And again, if you look at the past, we just have not done very much. If you even looked during the pandemic, we did not have a lot of effect at CO2 levels in the atmosphere. So we just have to do much more than we have done until the past, until actually we can start to move the dial. The things we've done in the past have not been enough to change anything in the climate as it is now changing. So we have tried to do something about the rate of change, and maybe in some years we have very slightly changed the rate of change, but it still kept warming. And it is still warming. And so some of the effects of CO2 emissions over the last centennia are still in the pipeline. We're not seeing them yet. And so whatever we do, it is still going to get warmer than today. And in my opinion, we have to really, really change the way we live if we want to prevent the world from going back to the Eocene, the period that we had no ice caps on the Antarctic. And for instance, what we see going on at the moment at the higher latitudes, those changes at the higher latitudes are exactly what we predicted, but they're happening faster than we predicted in the past. So I still don't want to sound alarmistic, which scientists didn't want to do, but I do think that we are in serious trouble, and that us humans, not for the planet, but for ourselves, we do have to change things very, very rapidly. We have to start taking action now.